Hey, what's up guys? Today I'll show you a horror film, Twilight Zone, the movie. Spoiler ahead, watch out and take care. The film begins with two men singing in the car as they drive on a country road late at night. The two men enjoy singing along with their music player when the cassette unfortunately breaks. The men are pissed because the radio does not work, so they just think of a game to entertain themselves. The driver turns off the headlights as he drives for the thrill. However, the passenger disagrees with him, as it is dangerous to drive in the dark without headlights. So the two make a game about TV theme songs. They hum and take turns which one will guess the answer. As the men entertain themselves, the conversation changes to their favorite episodes of Twilight Zone. They talk about the weirdest and scariest episodes they watched. Then out of the blue, the passenger asks the driver to stop the car, as he has something terrifying to show. The driver reluctantly pulls over, and the passenger turns his head for a few seconds. When the passenger turns around, he has turned into an animalistic creature, and attacks the driver. The driver screams in pain and horror, as the creature continues to attack him. The scene then changes to the narrator's voice, telling that imagination can unlock a mysterious door that leads to dimensions. There's the dimension of sound, sight, and mind. This leads to the first Twilight Zone anthology story, titled Time Out. It starts with a sour, lonely, and hateful man, Connor, entering a bar. Connor sits with his two friends and starts to complain about his work. The promotion he had been waiting for a long time was given to his Jew workmate. His disappointment causes him to make prejudiced and racist slurs towards Jews, blacks, and Asians. His voice is so loud that he attracts the attention of a group of black men sitting near them. Connor's friends apologize for his behavior, but he continues with his long tongue. As he gets more upset, Connor decides to leave the bar. However, when he exits, he finds the surroundings have completely changed, from a parking lot to empty streets set in France during World War II. Shortly after, two officers patrolling the streets spot Connor, and they suspect him as a Jew. They start to harass and insult him, but he cannot understand them as they speak in German. Confused and threatened, Connor runs his smelly ass away, but he gets shot in his hormone let-go arm during the chase. Connor hides in the dumpster as the officers blow their whistle, signaling backup. As they get out of sight, Connor enters an apartment from a nearby building and attempts to hide. However, the woman screams to the German soldiers that Connor is in her apartment. Connor climbs out on the building's ledge in a desperate attempt to escape, but he finds himself trapped. Soldiers come into the flat and try to take him. Instead of killing him right away, the two officers repeatedly shoot at Connor, indirectly targeting his head. Connor loses balance, slips off a ledge, and lands on soft ground. A group of people known as the Ku Klux Klan takes Connor because they see him as an African-American man. As the prominent members prepare to kill him, Connor tells them he is white. However, they do not see him as white, so Connor kicks a member against the burning cross, setting him on fire. Connor runs away to the nearby pond as the Klan chases him. As they corner him, the Klan simultaneously fires at Connor, so he dives into the water to avoid the bullets. However, when he resurfaces, he finds himself in another place. The surrounding is set to the Vietnam War, where the US soldiers fire their rifles at him, nearly killing him. This time, the soldiers see Connor as a Vietnamese, so they throw a grenade at him to ensure they kill him. As the grenade explodes, Connor returns to Nazi-occupied France, where the two officers capture him. They put him in a freight car, along with three other Jewish prisoners, with no possibility of redemption or rescue. The story ends with Connor screaming help to his friends from the bar that only he can see, as the vehicle drives away. The scene then transitions to the second story, entitled Kick the Can. It starts with Mr. Bloom, an old man who has just moved to his new home at a retirement home. As he sits with other elderly, a poor old man, named Mr. Conroy, complains about the kids playing outside. This causes a fascinating discussion, as the old people reminisce the joys they experienced in their youths. However, they cannot do as much as they did back then, because of their old age. Mr. Bloom cuts in, and claims that just because they are old, does not mean they cannot enjoy life anymore. Feeling young has something to do with their mind and attitude, not their age. Mr. Bloom then tells them that he will wake them up later that night, and they can either join him, or a children's game of kick the can. The residents happily agree except for Mr. Conroy, who opposes everything Mr. Bloom has said. Despite that, the residents contain their excitement as they wait for the night to come. After hours, the night has finally arrived, and Mr. Bloom wakes up the residents. Mr. Bloom gathers them outside, where they play the game. However, the residents mysteriously turn to the younger versions of themselves. The residents run and play around, as they enjoy their younger selves. However, they stop later and ask Mr. Bloom, as they realize something. Being young is fun, but it also means that they need to go through their lives' painful and bad moments again. The residents do not want to experience those pain again, so they request Mr. Bloom to turn them into their old selves again. They all return to their beds, where Mr. Conroy sees them as children. Mr. Conroy immediately finds a caretaker and takes her to the room where the residents have turned to their old selves again. However, a resident has remained a child, and Mr. Conroy suddenly wants to go with him when he runs off. Mr. Conroy finally realizes what Mr. Bloom has been talking about. He realizes that age does not stop him from enjoying his life. The story ends with Mr. Bloom leaving the retirement home to move into another one, while Mr. Conroy is outside happily playing kick the can. The scene then transitions to the third story, entitled It's a Good Life. It starts with a school teacher in her late 20s, driving across the country to the rural for her new job. Teacher stops at a local bar and asks the owner for directions. As the owner gives directions, two locals bully a young boy playing a video game for accidentally turning off the TV they are watching. Teacher helps the boy, who remains silent and leaves as he gets bullied. Because of that, teacher decides to go, but then she accidentally backs into the boy with her car. Teacher immediately helps the boy as his bike is damaged. The boy then asks teacher to drive him home, and she agrees. In the car, the boy introduces himself as Anthony, and he claims that today is his birthday, but his parents do not care. After hours of driving, they finally arrive at Anthony's house, which is an enormous and gorgeous home in the county. Anthony invites teacher inside, and she is immediately greeted by Anthony's uncle and his sister. Anthony's parents then come in from the kitchen, and they clamor around teacher like they never had a visitor. Teacher notices that the family is giving her too much attention, considering she almost runs over Anthony. But she dismisses it, as they insist she stay for dinner. Before Anthony shows her around, the family takes teacher's purse and jacket. As soon as she is out of sight, the family immediately goes through teacher's belongings. Meanwhile, teacher notices the house interior looks like it came out from cartoons. Teacher sees a woman watching a cartoon too closely in one of the rooms. Anthony shares that the woman is his other sister, who got into an accident. As they leave the room, the scene reveals that the woman has no mouth. After showing her around, the two return downstairs to the living room. The parents leave to get the food, but when they return, teacher is astonished. The dinner is fast food, a burger with peanut butter, which is Anthony's favorite. Teacher's curiosity heightens, so she asks the family if they continually eat fast food. The family replies that Anthony can eat anything he wants. Teacher concerningly replies that Anthony needs nutritious food for his age, which causes a momentarily awkward silence. Teacher breaks the silence, as she remembers that Anthony mentioned his birthday. However, the sister seems surprised, so she questions Anthony. But with one look at her plate smashes to the ground. Teacher attempts to leave, as things get more questionable, but Anthony stubbornly insists that she watch his uncle's trick. Although he is unsure, the uncle obliges Anthony's wish, like he was afraid of him. He then pulls out a white rabbit from a magic hat that Anthony provided. The family seems relieved for some unknowable reason, and applauds the uncle. However, the white rabbit suddenly becomes a monstrous, horrifying monster that looks like it came out from a cartoon. Anthony smiles as he watches the monster rabbit, but then he notices teacher screaming from fear. Anthony orders the monster rabbit to go away, and it does. Teacher immediately gets her belongings, but Anthony stops her again and pleads with her to stay. He promises to make everything and anything turn into whatever she wants. He then notices a piece of paper on the ground, revealing that the family needs help because Anthony is a monster. Anthony investigates who wrote the note, and the family blames it on the sister. As she gets cornered by Anthony, the sister reveals that they are not Anthony's real family. They were brought to the house under false pretense and were kept as prisoners in Anthony's fantasy world, which he created out of his mind. Anthony sends the sister to the cartoon land with his mental powers, where she is killed by a dragon-like cartoon character. Terrified by what she witnessed, teacher attempts to leave, only to see a huge eye waiting for her outside. Anthony then comes out and explains to teacher that he can do anything he wants with just the words "I wish." He then uses his mental powers again and creates a shape-shifting cartoon monster that terrifies the family and teacher. Although terrified, teacher firmly instructs Anthony to wish it away, which he reluctantly does. As they anger Anthony, his hatred causes him to wish it all away, causing the family and the house to disappear. Now Anthony and teacher are in a literal nothingness, where teacher promises Anthony that she will teach him how to control his power and put it to good use. Anthony agrees and produces teacher a car. The story ends with teacher driving to their new house, while Anthony uses his power and fills the meadows filled with bright flowers. The scene then transitions to the last story, entitled Nightmare at 20,000 Feet. It starts with a man, named Mr. Valentine, having a panic attack in the airplane bathroom. The pilot announces that they need to return to their seats, as the plane will experience tremendous turbulence from a storm. Two flight attendants patiently wait for Mr. Valentine until he comes out of the bathroom. The attendants help Mr. Valentine return to his seat, reassuring him that everything will be all right. It seems like Mr. Valentine has severe claustrophobia. As he returns to his seat, lightning repeatedly roars, causing Mr. Valentine to look through the window. However, he does not expect to see a grim-like creature on the plane's left wing, causing more panic in him. He watches as the creature destroys the wing, causing him to scream out loud, disturbing passengers. The passengers look through the window to see what he is talking about, but they do not see anything. Mr. Valentine checks it, and it is true. There is nothing out there. Mr. Valentine apologizes for his behavior, as his mind plays a trick on him. The flight attendant closes the window blind, so Mr. Valentine can sleep. However, Mr. Valentine still cannot sleep, as he thinks the creature is still outside. As he loses self-control, Mr. Valentine opens the window blind, only to be surprised by the creature looking directly at him. Mr. Valentine immediately screams in panic, but a passenger, the flight attendant, and the first officer pilot hold him down. The passenger turns out to be an air marshal, so he offers help. But the pilot kindly refuses, and handles Mr. Valentine on his own. He calms down Mr. Valentine, and explains that he needs to be calm until they land, or they would have to cuff him. The pilot also explains that a flash of lightning struck an engine outside. The plane has four engines, and there will be no safety problems. As he calms down a bit, the pilot leaves him, but then they experience the tremendous turbulence from the storm. Mr. Valentine looks through the window again, only to see that the creature is back at destroying the engines. This pushes him to the edge, so he attempts to break the window, using an oxygen tank that has rolled through the aisle from the turbulence. The air marshal immediately holds him down, but Mr. Valentine is beyond help. He grabs the marshal's handgun and shoots the window, causing a breach in the pressurized cabin. The marshal holds Mr. Valentine, as half of his body is out the window. Despite that, he repeatedly shoots the creature, but he fails to even hit it. The creature promptly faces Mr. Valentine, destroys the gun, and leaps to the sky, as the plane begins to make an emergency landing. The plane safely lands in an airport, where the delirious and incoherent Mr. Valentine is wrapped in a straitjacket, and took off in an ambulance. The passengers, the police, and the airport crew begin to discuss the incident, claiming that Mr. Valentine is insane. Shortly after, the airplane maintenance crew arrives, and they find unexplained scratches on the plane's left wing. The driver plays Creedence Clearwater Revival's Midnight Special in the ambulance. The film ends with the narrator's voice, saying that there is a fifth dimension beyond what is known to man. It is the middle ground between light and shadow, science and superstition, and lies between the pit of man's fears and the summit of his knowledge. It is the dimension of imagination. It is an area which is called the Twilight Zone. This is Daniel CC Movie Channel. Stay safe and enjoy your day.